Okay, good morning, everybody. So my name is Eric Auger. I work in the Linaro Virtualization Group, as Alex, and I'm an ST Microelectronics assignee. And today, I'm going to talk about assignment of platform devices to KVM guests. So just to remind you of the goal of this, so it consists in allowing the guest to have the most optimized access to a platform device that is assigned to it, meaning that it has an exclusive access to the device. And the hypervisor needs to set up the most optimized routes for MMIO accesses and IRQ injection. And also the IOMMU is involved in guaranteeing that DMA accesses of the devices are not going to jeopardize the integrity of the other virtual machines. So assignment of PCI devices is available for a while now, and allowing assignment of platform devices is something that is rather new, which is not upstream yet. And this is what we are going to talk about today. So I did not mention that, so I have about 30 slides, so I would prefer to take questions afterwards, if you don't mind. So here is the outline of my presentation. So first of all, I will remind you of the VFIO framework, which is the cornerstone of platform device pass-through in KVM. I will, of course, explain how QMU uses it to perform pass-through, to set up the pass-through. And then most of my presentation will be specialized to interrupt handling, because this is where we found the most important challenges in terms of optimization. So I'm going to explain the legacy framework that already exists for PCI and which are reused for platform device pass-through. And then I'm going to introduce a technique that is implemented on ARM. It is ARM specific today, but it could be used potentially by other architectures, which we call IRQ forwarding. And we will see how this new technique is integrated with the existing software pieces, which are VFIO, IRQFD, and KVM VFIO as well. And at the end of my presentation, I will present some preliminary results, performance results, based on CAC-SEDA Midway hardware, which is the ARM V7. Okay, so let's start with the cornerstone, as I said, which is the VFIO driver. So again, the VFIO PCI driver exists for a while, but now there is a VFIO platform driver, which is looming, and it is currently in its V8 version, so it becomes closer to the upstream, I hope. So as the PCI fellow driver, the VFIO platform driver allows to provide user space access to hardware hardware resources of any platform device. Those resources typically are the register space, the physical IRQs, and so what it makes possible is to mmap the register space on user side using file descriptor. It makes possible also to route the physical IRQs to event FDs. And also, it is possible to map buffers in the IOMMU, which, as I explained before, is mandatory for isolation sake. Okay, so now we come to explain how QMU is using this VFIO platform driver. So the principle is that we are going to unbind the native platform driver So let's say it is an XGMAC, for instance. We are going to unbind it and bind in its place the VFIO driver. And we are going to tell QEMU to expose all the hardware resources of the platform device using the VFIO driver, because we saw the basic functionalities the VFIO driver is exposing to the user space. So in QEMU, we are going to instantiate what we call the QEMU VFIO device. This guy is using both the VFIO driver and KVM to set up the routes that makes possible for the guest to have the most optimized access to the physical device. Those routes are related to the MMU settings, of course, to the IO MMU settings, and also related to the interrupt injection. Also, the QEMU VFIO device will generate the device tree node for the guest to be aware that it can use a device of a given type, which will be abstracted by the VFIO driver on the host side. So now let's have a look at the MMIO and interrupts path. I would say that once the routes related to system MMU and MMU are set up by KVM, the hypervisor is not involved anymore in those accesses. However, if we look at the way interrupts are handled, there is no way to inject interrupt directly into the guest. So each time there is a physical interrupt that arrives, we are obliged to go through the hypervisor, and we have a routing that is put in place by putting a kind of collaboration between the VFIO driver and KVM that makes possible to inject the interrupt into the guest. And this is what we are going to focus on today. And I'm going to present the legacy framework, which is based on VFIO and KVM IRQFD, and then introduce a new one. But so before digging into the details of how we inject an IRQ, I just would like to remind everyone about how a simple IRQ, native physical IRQ, is handled. And I will take the example of ARM because this is the one I know the best. So on this picture, you have the two kinds of two drawings. The top one is representing a level sensitive IRQ, and at the bottom, you have the edge sensitive case. So at the very top, you have the line, which is asserted by the peripheral. Just below, with the color shading, you have the interrupt controller state. And in blue, you have the interrupt service routine. So what we can see here is when, so for the level sensitive IRQ, when the peripheral is asserting the line, putting the level high, at interrupt controller level, so I will say geek, because this is the term for ARM, the geek puts the IRQ in the pending state, and at some point of time, this IRQ will be signaled to the CPU interface, and this will start the interrupt service routine. And the first thing the interrupt service routine does is it acknowledges the IRQ to get the interrupt ID, and that at that point, the geek puts the IRQ in the active state, and since the line is still high, it is a level sensitive IRQ, it is active and pending. Then the ISR executes. At some point of time, it will access the peripheral to reset the IRQ status register. And at that point, the peripheral deasserts the line. And at geek state, this means that the IRQ is not pending anymore, but just active because the ISR has not completed. And from that point on, the peripheral can assert the line again. This is what is represented, but maybe it's a bit misleading here. What I want to show then is that when the ISR eventually completes, it deactivates the IRQ, meaning the geek will remove the active state and just leave it as either pending if the IRQ was asserted again or in the inactive state. Okay, so this is the basic handling. And we will mostly focus on this deactivation stuff in the rest of the presentation. So I will not cover into more details the edge sensitive case, which is basically the same thing, except that instead of being obliged to bother with the line, with the line of the peripheral, which is still high after the assertion, so the state becomes simply active, and so it's even more simple, I would say. So now we have seen the basic behavior. So now let's see what it means to inject this IRQ into a guest. So this is the basic model of what we would like to implement. So on the top, you have the physical IRQ, and then I try to represent the virtual IRQ lifecycle. So what will happen, the physical IRQ, it's on the host, there is the ISR that will start running when the physical IRQ is signaled on the CPU interface. So this ISR today is the VFIO ISR. The VFIO ISR will signal an event FD, which will trigger in another thread the injection of the virtual IRQ. So we have to model, so we will enter into more details about how the virtual IRQ is injected, but we have to model a kind of state machine for the virtual IRQ. This is done on ARM in the vgeek.c file. And so this is part of KVM. And so then we actually inject the virtual IRQ into the guest. This time, this is the IGMAC, because we assign an IGMAC ISR that is running. And this IGMAC, at some point of time, will perform a direct access to the peripheral register space to deassert the physical line. With some magic, we must toggle down the virtual IRQ we model in KVM. And eventually, when the ISR completes, there is a deactivation on the virtual side. We are talking about the virtual IRQ here. And by some magic, as well, we must deactivate the physical IRQ on the host side. And only at that time, we can signal a new physical IRQ on host. So this is what we want to implement, and I'm going to detail how it is currently done with the VFIO and IRQFD, and how we can improve that. So, just to summarize, the main challenges we have with this implementation is that you remember you have to deactivate the physical IRQ at some point of time. The problem, if we do that just after at the completion of the ISR, we are going to resample the line, and this is not what we want to do. So we must make sure that the physical IRQ can be signaled again to the CPU interface at the point where we deactivate the virtual IRQ. So we have to guarantee that this life cycle. Obviously, what is complex is to model the virtual IRQ. This is a software modeling which happens in KVM. And which is related to the point one, we have to propagate the completion of the virtual IRQ to the host. This is what is complex. So now, how is it implemented with VFIO together with IRQFD? What happens is that on physical, on host side, at the end of the ISR, you deactivate the physical IRQ, but you also mask it. So this means that from that point on, it cannot be signaled again to the CPU interface. So this is what we want, because else we would resample the line. So the ISR triggers an event FD, which is handled in KVM IRQFD thread, which injects the IRQ into the VGeek. And so we make sure in the VGeek that from that point on, there is no new injection for this IRQ that can happen. So then the VM becomes to be running. The ISR, the virtual IRQ is signaled to the virtual CPU interface. The ISR starts, acknowledge the IRQ, and so DSR the line at some point of time using direct access, so through the MMU settings, stage one and stage two. And at the end, it deactivates. And on ARM, what it happens is that we are going to trap this deactivation using what is called a maintenance IRQ. And the effect is that you trap on the hypervisor side. Then you go to host, you execute the ISR, and in another thread, actually, you are going to... it's oversimplified here, because there are two threads. First, you enter into KVM threads, and then you enter into VFIO, VIRQ thread. And the eventual thread both unmask the physical IRQ and also allow a new injection of the virtual IRQ. So this is how it is implemented today with VFIO and IRQFD. And so we have some kind of complexity which is related to the mask-unmask action of the VFIO driver. And also, most importantly, we have a trap on completion. So meaning that the performance challenge is that we have two traps, one for the injection and one for the completion. And on ARM especially, the switch, the VM switch is quite costly. So what we want to propose is a new technique that is based on the Geek hardware virtualization feature, which would make possible to remove the switch at the completion. And this is what I'm going to talk about. Okay, hopefully, the Geek brings some interesting virtualization features. So we have seen already one of them, which is the principle of the maintenance IRQ, which makes possible to trap the deactivation of the guest. And there is another mode which exists at Geek level, which allows the Geek to automatically deactivate the physical IRQ when it detects the guest completes the virtual IRQ. So obviously, if we use that mode, this means that the ownership of the completion is transferred from the host to the guest, because the guest completes, and then automatically the hardware completes the physical IRQ. So this means that the generic IRQ code of the host must be changed, because the completion cannot happen two times at two different places. So the idea is that we are going to use another Geek mode, which separates the actual drop of the CPU interface running priority from the very deactivation. So instead of having one action that does at the same time the drop of the interrupt priority and the deactivation, so the Geek allows to have two different separate commands. The first one dropping the priority. At that point of time, you will allow new physical IRQs to be signaled to the CPU interface. But the outstanding IRQ cannot be signaled. Okay, so this is the priority drop. And separately from this action, you will be able to deactivate the IRQ. And at that point of time, you will move the state of the IRQ from active to inactive, or active and pending. So Mark offered a patch that makes possible to enable the modes I've just described. So the fact that we are separating the priority drop from the deactivation. And Mark's patch also offers so separate operation to program the IRQ chips and the VGeek. The IRQ chip must be told that for this specific IRQ, it must not deactivate the IRQ on the end of interrupt, but just drop the priority. So this is a special behavior. And on VGeek side, in order to activate the fact that when the guest deactivates the virtual IRQ, it automatically deactivates the physical IRQ, you must provide the VGeek with the correspondence between the virtual IRQ and the physical IRQ. So there is a special programming that must happen, and it happens typically when you post the virtual IRQ in the hardware. So with this mechanism, what is changed is that instead of masking and deactivating the physical IRQ, you simply drop the priority. At that point, new physical IRQ of different IRQ number can be signaled to the CPU interface. But the current IRQ is not deactivated, so this means that it cannot hit again. Okay? Only when the guest deactivates the virtual IRQ, so the geek automatically completes the physical one, and at that time, the same IRQ can be signaled again to the CPU interface. So the advantage is that you do not bother anymore about mask and unmask. Obviously, it does not trigger a VM switch at deactivation. And so I would say this is the most natural and optimized implementation we can reach on ARM today. And this is also the method that is advised by ARM. I think it is already implemented like that on Xen. They are using that feature. So we think this is a good direction. So using that mode, actually, you only have to take care about the software injection, but the completion is done in hardware. So it looks simpler using that that illustration. So now, how does it integrate together with the existing software components? So we are not changing the way we are injecting the IRQ, actually. We are still using the VFIO platform driver along with IRQFD because the VFIO driver makes an association between the IRQ index and an event FD, and the IRQFD makes an association between the event FD and the virtual IRQ, which is also called the GSI. We are only changing the way we are implementing the back channel, I would say, the completion path. And for that, we are proposing to use the KVM VFIO device, which was already used to inform KVM about the VFIO groups. So we are extending this capability. The KVM VFIO device is in charge of programming in a consistent manner both IRQ chip, but also KVM, and will also interrogate the VFIO platform driver to retrieve the hardware IRQ that corresponds to the IRQ index that is passed in the user API. So we are not changing the philosophy. So before, IRQ index was used. So we are not exposing the actual IRQ number to the user space. This new API makes possible for the user space to configure the forwarding for a VFIO device IRQ. So we are passing the VFIO file descriptor, the IRQ index, and the virtual IRQ it corresponds to. Okay, so there is a patch that was submitted that needs some cleaning, but this is the way we plan to implement it. Also, I forgot to mention that in case the IRQ is forwarded the way I described before, the VFIO platform driver does not need to mask, unmask the IRQ, so it interrogates the IRQ chip to know what it needs to do. Okay, so I've completed with the overall description of the mechanism, so now let's talk about preliminary performance results. So for that, I use the Calceda Midway. I use two nodes of the server, which are connected to a 1 gigabit switch. So Calceda Midway, the SOC, has a 4F15, and it has also two XGMAX. One can be assigned to the host, and the other one can be assigned to the guest when virtualization is running. So I'm using a 3.17 RC-free version for the kernel, so everywhere, and QEMU 2.1. So here is a kind of pattern I've been running. So without virtualization, so this is what I call native performance, I am running a net server on one node and a netperf client on the other one. And so in most of the cases, I run netperf. I try sometimes also iperf and netcat, but most of the results I will present are based on netperf. And I use three different scripts, so stream, myers, which corresponds to the receiver channel, and RTT. And when I run with virtualization, so I launch the same thing, but this time on the guest, which is using ETH1 instead of ETH0, ETH1 being assigned to the guest. So let's start first with the round trip time that is measured with the TCP RR. The native performance I am observing is 18,000 transactions per second, approximately. And so I run the guest with three kinds of configuration, so it can be... So I mostly talk about the standard IRQ FD path and forwarding path. I also tried VirtIONet, but here, to anticipate any question, so I'm not sure I use it in the most optimized way, because I'm using the... VFIONet device version, and I didn't find the multi-queue option. So maybe this is not correctly used. This is not my specialty at all. And no IRQ FD is actually when we handled the VFIO event FDs on user side, which is absolutely not the best solution in terms of performance, but it also exists, and I wanted to compare simply. Just to focus on the two solutions we mostly evoked during this presentation. I observe 2.5 improvement of forwarding over IRQ FD. So it is quite small. Also, I did the same experience, but UDP RR. And this time, I got a 5% improvement. So it gives an idea of the performance improvement we have. This I will keep for next. So in terms of throughput, so first of all, I would acknowledge I'm not a network expert at all. So I measured three kinds of patterns, which I found in the literature. So default, file, and bulk. So what I'm varying here is the socket buffer size and also the user buffer size. So I'm not able to show any difference between IRQFD and forwarding with a bulk pattern. However, I am able to show significant improvement on the throughput using the default and file patterns. So to be honest, I have difficulties to interpret those figures. So I present the figures as I collected it. So what I suspect is that on default and file, I have much more CPU load. Also, there is some throttling that is put in place by a TCP/IP stack, and this may explain why you have so much difference. So it can it goes up to 30% improvement between IRQFD standard solution and forwarding. Also, I observe the number of IRQs I had on the guest using IRQFD and forward, and I compared that with the native rate. So typically, on the host without virtualization, I have this figure about the number of IRQs per second. Here you have the percentage versus native, and you can see that the rate observed on the guest is far less than on native side. With TCP/IR, I have exactly the same improvement as the latency figure. I suspect it is normal because you send wait for the reception and so on. But for the for TX and RX scripts, I can see that I have a large improvement of the number of IRQs that are handled in forward case compared to IRQFD case. So to me, it's a bit difficult to interpret because the performance being different, you can have some throttling that is put in place, so I'm not sure I'm comparing exactly the same scenarios of TCP/IPs. Okay, so here's the status of those works on ARM. So first of all, nothing is upstreamed today. On QEMU side, we have this VFIO platform device, and we also have patches related to the dynamic instantiation of this VFIO platform device. So I reuse the work done by Alex on E5000. And on kernel side, so the basic dependency is the VFIO platform driver, and also the patch from Mark, obviously. And then we brought IRQFD support on ARM, and we have this KVM VFIO implementation as well to do the forwarding. So I just want to say that you can already try a platform device assignment without the forwarding feature. If you want, it's even more mature. So the conclusion is that I would say we have the main functional bricks that enable efficient platform device pass-through. Obviously, we do not have MSI support yet, but I think it will show up later on. So on ARM, we have level sensitive IRQs which are prevalent. So it was very important to improve that support. And I was able to show that always we can find an improvement of forwarding over IRQFD, so related to the IRQ rate, related to the throughput and latency. So throughput, it's not, it depends on the pattern, typically. So I would encourage you to test this and start integrating your device. And So I must acknowledge that the Calceda XGMAC is quite simple in terms of device tree. There is no dependency on file nodes or on clocks. So it would help to assign a more complex device in terms of device tree node. And there is work ongoing on 64-bit as well. So I've done so. I'm done with my presentation, so are there any questions?
Yeah.
Yes, please.
So you're basically using the
Sorry, can you repeat, please?
Yeah, so the forwarding feature, is that using the priority drop deactivate feature of ARM?
Yes, we do. So we separate the priority drop from the deactivation. And so this corresponds to the EOI mode equal to 1, if you know in detail.
So you're basically pushing up in the list register, you're specifying the physical.
Yes, exactly. Instead of we are playing on the hardware bit, so we are setting the hardware bit to 1, saying that this is an assigned IRQ, a physical IRQ, and we put the correspondence between the virtual IRQ and the physical IRQ in the list register when we post the virtual.
So then once you acknowledge it, you're actually acknowledging the physical IRQ.
No,
we actually, when you EOI the guest, you are deactivating the interrupt on the host. And the acknowledgement occurs when the guest, well, the acknowledgement occurs on the host when it reads the IRQ. And then you have a guest doing its own acknowledgement for virtual key. But that's a little bit soft of that. But what Derek's presenting here is actually the deactivation pattern. EOI path from the guest. When the guest has the EOI, that starts to translate to the activation of
it. Right, but essentially it doesn't cause an exit, right?
Sorry?
I mean, essentially it does not cause an exit.
No, it doesn't cause an exit. That's the whole idea. The whole idea is to save this VM exit, which can be quite costly or not.
Yeah, because I mean, that's something I implemented like ages ago.
It's basically how you could implement the budget interrupt. You can completely consider the VM as being just a threat. It's a threat interrupt handler.
Yes, actually, when you look at the ARM specification of the geek, it clearly says that the advertised and advised way to handle physical IRQs is the one we use in forwarding mode. Okay, so we were not using it yet, but we are putting this in.
It's just that.
Well, I know some people, like Antonio's and some guys were against using this kind of speech. And so I'm just kind of surprised to see that.
Yeah, it comes late, but it comes.
I think people are. I've pushed back on that historically because it's always been tied to the whole. Oh, I want different interrupts with different priorities, which has been more common. But you don't have to use multiple priorities to do that feature. It's actually very useful as possible.
But I wanted to show as well, since we are deactivating the physical IRQ automatically, it breaks somehow, or at least it modifies the way IRQFD is used, because we have no resample FD called anymore, so it's a little change compared to what was done before.
Oh, okay, so the sample short is gone?
Yes, yes. Yeah.
It's also worth mentioning that this EOI mode is quite fundamental if you want to be able to go through just the timer to the guest. At the moment, we have a global hack where we actually present an already masked timer interrupt to the guest, which means Linux works, but QNX doesn't, for example. This EOI mode allows us to actually present already active interrupt to the guest and be able to context switch it really nicely without any addition.
You mentioned that AR64 was kind of on the to-do list. I guess some of this doesn't seem AR64 specific, like the QMU side necessarily. So what's left to do for AR64 to enable that?
Actually, just testing, and yes, because we have never tried on this. Typically, the IMMU settings as well. So there is work ongoing with one SOC vendor that tries to assign also an XGMAC on ARM64. And in this case, we have a more complex device tree node as well. So it's interesting to know what to do with the clocks, with the file, and so on. So, but it's just testing. So it should work, yes, effectively, it should work.
Injection app to accelerate things there. But one thing we were thinking of on power, on embedded power, was to so there's a special mode where you can have the CPU already enact the interrupt when the interrupt handler gets called, basically. When you get the interrupt, it already has the interrupt knowledge, and you can just read the interrupt ID from a register, and that means you can basically have really early code that in your case would be in hype mode. They could interrupt this in a bitmap. This is an interrupt that I need to forward to the guest, and it just goes and do it. Could you do something similar on ARM?
I can answer that. I don't think we have any hardware for it. You may get that. But you could build something that would mitigate the huge cost it takes to go and add and inject the virtual interrupt. You could build something potentially if you're taking the interrupt from out of the core. But you'd have to build a proper infrastructure that doesn't lead to a terrible hack because all high nodes levels are separate.
And you have to special whether you can make sense and think about, you know, what kind of under which kind of loads with kind of extra cores that you have as well. So that makes sense. But it is something we have to talk about. Okay. Other question? Okay, thanks. So if there are some network experts in the room, so I would be happy to discuss the benchmarks results, if you can help me to interpret what happens. So thank you. Thank you.